warrior that lives inside of you, my friend.
45 minutes are ahead of us. Honduras will try to rescue another good result as they have done in their last two visits to Estadio Azteca. Play on is what Drew Fisher said. The story has a Mexico leading 1-0. The lone goal was scored by Osvaldo Alanis Pantoja, a champion in Liga MX with Chivas, and a guy who is fighting for the possibility to be a part of the starting 11 on June 18 when Mexico plays Portugal in their first match of the FIFA Confederations Cup. This is the first foul of the second half. It's going to be against Oliver David Bonasan Torres.
And that first foul came pretty quick. Now, I mentioned about if this game was going to get a little bit chippy in the second half, and within a minute, there's already a tough tackle.
And there's a concept that it's not written, Kobe, but if it's not for the quality of the foul, it's for the amounts of fouls that some players have committed during the game so far. Morazan, it's one of them. Jonah. Vela got the worst part of the play. And Morazan was in the middle again.
Well, Morazan is playing in that defensive position, one of those two holding midfielders to really be in there, destroy everything and clog up those passing lanes. One of the things he has to do is be that tough tackler. Now he's just got to play a little bit safe because he's on the radar of the referee right now. A couple of fouls early on in the match. You get a couple more, you can find yourself picking up a card.
That's Salcedo. Clearing the ball. 50-50 that Jimenez put down. Now we're going back to Carlos Joel Salcedo. Reyes. Beware because Diego has committed a couple of mistakes playing for the national team that ended up in guns against. This is a foul committed over El Zurdo Mario Roberto Martinez. Very discreet game for El Zurdo. So is for Eric Candino. And what about Albert Ellis, the striker, the killer? Without balls, you can't do anything.
Yeah, you can run around up top all day, but if you're not getting the service and with the ball at your feet, you're not going to have that opportunity to be that dangerous striker that we know that Ellis is.
Here comes El Zurdo. Swing in. He put it away.
At some point, there has to be an understanding. You have to feel the game, as some of my old coaches used to say. You have to feel the way the ball is flying through the air. And they're continuously, Honduras, off of set pieces, hitting this ball way too far, and it's just flying up and out of bounds.
And probably the most frustrating situation about that play, Kobe, is that comes from one of the leaders, from one of the experienced players that should...
You should
make
know.
The example. Yeah, yeah, they should make the example. It was Corona, and now it's Jonah. That's a foul committed over Martinez Hernandez. Yeah, you can make the difference on behalf of your teams when, of your teammates, when you are that experienced guy, the man who can think, distribute the game, drive the ball, but he's not doing that.
Yeah, and I give leeway at the beginning of a match because you're still trying to figure it out, even with warm-up and all that. It still takes about 10, 15 minutes to really get to know the flight of the during the run of play. But after that, there needs to be some type of consistency. That is why you are a national team player. That's why you're considered one of the best in your country.
Ellis, I don't know if he was aiming for Andino, but he put it away. We suddenly saw Crisanto, and this is Minor from far. And the ball goes wide. At least Minor Alexis tried something.
Well, at least it was a shot on goal, but I'm not going to give it too much credit because I don't think you're going to be scoring on Ochoa from about 50 yards out. That was pretty hopeful.
I understand, but if you see it from the mental point, isn't that like you crush the ball and you yell your teammates, snap out of it, let's play, let's go.
Well, see, I look at that's frustration. because nothing else is coming. They've got to find a way.
Here's Corona. Very well defended by Crisanto. Then the foul over Giovanni. It was the opposite. Have you heard the expression about reading people?
Reading people?
I haven't been able to read this referee. The way he has been seeing the game, judging the game. You think you're going on his path, and then he turns. You think you're getting the idea, and then he turns around again.
Well, that's always difficult. If we're having a tough time, it's difficult for the players especially.
And more if you are playing for the frustrated team, like we were talking a couple of minutes ago about Lache. Jonah. Bella. I think Bella had another soft contact on one of his legs. Gio. Aiming. Herrera with the right bazooka leg. And El Zorrillo has been blocked. Now the opportunity for Bonzi. And Huesos was fighting for possession. He won the battle. This is the opportunity for El Tecatito. El Zurdo is behind again. Now Corona, very close, but defending was the man, was the captain, was the Jutipiante, Maynard Alexis Figueroa Roches.
Wow, this is just a little bit of a dance here. Hello, poor defending right there by Martinez. And then, hello, I'm going to put this right through the legs. And it ends up being the captain, Maynard Figueroa, that has to slide over for that defensive help. The last hope to see that ball out.
First corner kick in the second half for Mexico. When Salcedo is down, this are bad news for the Mexican side, because Carlos Joel is in the finalist for the Confederations Cup. Martinez is out. Coming in is Oscar Boniek Garcia.
Well, I think that makes sense. As we saw the poor defending that came from Mario Martinez. I think at that point, the coaches was like, you know what? We've got to make a change here to get a little bit more energy. You know, Boniek Garcia can be that player. He has that individual talent that he can make something happen on his own.
One of the five MLSer players that are with Honduras. Set play for Mexico. We're approaching minute 53. And we have the first substitution for Mexico. The cross, the header. And over the line, Honduras is saving what seems to be the second for Mexico. One more. Jimenez. And then trying to clear the ball. It was deflected by Jimenez. This is the previous play, Kobe.
And Dos Santos puts it in. And this is just another great opportunity for Mexico, as Diego Reyes, he just pulls off of the line. And once again for Honduras, look at that. Nobody is around him, even challenging him on the header. It's a redirected header towards goal. Escobar comes up with the big save.
I believe the ball was deflected by Crisanto, but because he was there, not he tried to deflect it. And my question is, was that a header from Reyes aiming at goal, or he was flicking it to Bella, who was at the far post?
Now that's Reyes going towards goal. I'll tell you, any defender that's in that area and he has a free header, he's thinking, I'm getting a goal. Defenders don't get the glory very much, but when they have the opportunity, they're going for it. And here is, he thinks that this is going in. It's a little bit of a deflection. Escobar, a great reactionary save. But like you said, Bella at the far post, well, that is just the thinking of a quick-witted striker, knowing that how many balls just go over the inline near that far post. And he's just standing there hoping he can get a nice, easy tap in.
Francisco X. Rivera is very close to the Mexican bench, and he has another report about the El Tricolor.
Well, you guys talk about the Confederations Cup list, but Mexico also released their 40-man prelim roster for the upcoming Gold Cup in July. There are several guys that are in both lists. Some of them, Rafa Márquez, there's Néstor Araujo, Oribe Peralta, Rodolfo Cota. And even though Juan Carlos Osorio had previously said that no player was actually going to repeat rosters, it seems that he's actually changing his mind. He actually told me yesterday that if some guys are not active or play a little during Russia, they'll actually be on the roster during Gold Cup.
And here comes one of the big questions that we were analyzing after getting the so far last list for the Mexican side. That the left side, it's a much stronger compared to the right one. And if Carlos Salcedo is injured and can't play because he left the game with a problem on his leg left leg, what's going to happen? Dueñas isn't a part of the final list. He can be called because there's a window before the beginning of the tournament where you can call other players if it's due to an injury. And there's the second substitution for the Mexican side. Giovanni is out, and El Chucky, Irving Lozano, it's in. I think Irving's nickname is very easy, right? Chucky, like the...
Chucky, like the doll?
Yeah.
Okay, that was easy enough.
I'm giving you some slack, my friend.
I like that one. I like Chucky.
Honduras still one goal behind. The header! It was alone! Maynard Figueroa tried it and put it over the crossbar defended by Paco Memochoa.
Juan Carlos Osorio can be frustrated on that one because that was a great opportunity. A far ball drifting to the back post, and Maynard Figueroa just a nice bending run to be able to get his head on this one. You know, and he gets into the position where he's able to out jump his mark.
Alanis.
And you can see the frustration. Figueroa knows that he has to get that one at least on target to test Ochoa in the net.
Is Honduras pulling up their lines?
It looks like they're finally starting to go for it to make a little bit of a push in this second half. I think the addition of Boniac Garcia has really helped, as he's going to be an offensive-minded only type of player. It has a little bit more speed, so that will push the back line a little bit of Mexico.
Here comes a cross from Boniac. No luck this time for Garcia Ramirez. I kind of sense a big confusion between Boniac and Crisanto. Oscar was signaling El Calaverita where to move, but suddenly Felix Juan just stood there, flat feet.
Well, sometimes it's difficult for a player that has just come into the game to be able to have that relationship with someone that's been playing for a 50-some plus odd minutes at Azteca Stadium. The player that's been on the field, a little bit more tired, a little bit slower to react, maybe, and not understanding everything that you want from him.
Yeah, but I insist that for that, you need to work. You need to try the players to know each other, how they think, what they want. There was another substitution for the Honduran side. Romel Kyoto is in. Another player from Houston Dynamo. And Eric Andino is out. So we have two substitutions per side. Only one remaining for each coach. Boniek with the flicker. Now there's a foul. Yes, it was Herrera over Claros. Defending is Vela. Trying to push the lines away from La Bicolor. The Mexican side, Jimenez, stealing the ball. The partner is Lozano. And now the one intercepted is El Rulo. Oops. About to lose the ball. That was Johnny Palacios. Izaguirre. Aiming for Ellis. Now it's Bonzi. Lead pass for Corona. Tecatito in the penalty area with a cruel side to side. New Mexican player was able to finish it. And Mexico just lost the opportunity to widen his lead 2-0.
Well, Honduras is getting caught with that high line once again. And as they are pushing more numbers forward, playing a little bit more aggressive from the back line, you're going to see more of this from Mexico. Players trying to beat that trap. And it's so interesting to me that the keeper isn't playing very far off of his line. So there's going to be a lot of space for Mexico to attack into.
Here's Vela. From Herrera. And then Alanis. Now with Jonah. The chipper. Lozano with the right. Ooh! He thought. He tried and he put it over the crossbar, but Honduras was about to feel the power of Chucky.
Yeah, well, you can see there's the line again. He's in an onside position, but this time instead of really breaking the line, it's coming from that outside in position. And I have to wonder why Escobar is taking so long to get off of his line. He comes out, gets trapped in no man's land, and very lucky that Chucky puts it over the bar. Do you like how I use that? I use the nickname.
The power of Chucky. You and I are in the same frequency, my friend. The big difference is that you're a Hall of Famer and I'm not.
Here's Banek with the cross. Well defended. And now Reyes clearing it. Jimenez. Vela. And it's Lozano. Mano y mano con Izaguirre. Minor. One more try, aiming for Ellis.
Alanis has done an excellent job in the back line of Mexico, just eating up any long ball that has come his way, being able to chest it and bring it down, being able to head him out. That is confidence. And that's what was wanted from Osorio, is someone in that back line to exude confidence and take over the back line.
Reyes. I think that was a foul over Jimenez. The other Reyes. The bumper. Where's Vela? It hasn't been the super player we were expecting for Lozano for the second opportunity to break away with the run!
Like this, he's in an onside position. You play a high line when your keeper is sitting on the goal line and there's no pressure on the ball. Look at that, no pressure on the surface whatsoever. You will get beat all day. I could go out there now and still make these runs and get the ball. This is absolutely brilliant by Irving Lozano. That outside in run again, a great service over the top, and Lozano is able to celebrate.
And if there's a man who has been able to change the destiny of this match, that's Irving Lozano. Hold on. I'm going to hold that name. It's been the power of Chucky.
All right. Chucky gets the goal. But I'm still wondering, what is Honduras thinking with that line? There is, you cannot, that is soccer 101. You cannot have a high line like that with your keeper sitting so far back and no pressure on the service. There is no one within 5 yards of the service, so the player is able to just pick his head up, look to see who is running, has the pace to get behind, and just pick out exactly where you want to put it.
And somebody who knows personally the power of Chucky, who has been following Irving Lozano closely for the last couple of weeks, that's Francisco X. Rivera. What is your report, my friend?
Well, Jorge, such an important goal for Irving Lozano. He has been under such media scrutiny with comments about him underachieving with the Mexican national team despite the great performances with Pachuca. And something else that's obviously distracting him right now, all the talk about him leaving Pachuca for Celta in Spain. We've heard that talks are very advanced and he might be leaving Mexico pretty soon. So an important, very important goal for Irving Lozano.
Thank you to the X-Men. There's been a couple of rumors around Lozano. One of them was, where is he going to keep playing the next season? But also that apparently there were a couple of offers. One coming from England, that the money wasn't what Pachuca wanted. And the other one coming from Germany. But apparently Lozano said that if he was going to play in Europe, he wanted to do it in Spain, not in Germany, due to the language. Same thing happened with a proposal coming from the Netherlands.
Well, it's good to have choices, isn't it? When you have the option to go with different places.
Here's Vela to Jimenez with the left, the chipper!
Once again, a high line by Honduras, and this is just a brilliant ball that's just played in. And Jimenez, as Escobar slowly comes out, just a little chip. And this is just a true striker's goal. There's a little bit of a glance, the knowledge of where the keeper is. And this one, it's just got to make you smile, because this really puts an exclamation point on this match. Puts an exclamation point on Azteca Stadium. Puts an exclamation point on this Mexican national team being the leaders right now of the Hex.
Raul Jimenez trusts himself. Certainly, after Real Madrid beat Juventus at the final of the UEFA Champions League, Cristiano Ronaldo was selected to be the cover of a very popular video game. And Raul Jimenez made news saying, if Cristiano Ronaldo is gonna be the cover around the world, I wanna be the cover of the same video game in Portugal. Why not? He won the Taça de Portugal as I did last Sunday. Another one for Chucky! Oh my! Oh my! Lozano had it, he tried it, and he put it over the crossbar.
This is just a brilliant performance by Mexico right now. But as we take a look at Irving Lozano, gets in behind the defense once again. Reactionary runs by the defense of Honduras. It's almost like they're always a step behind. At this point, defensively, you've got to say, okay, let's drop in a little bit. Let's not have players consistently getting behind us, because look, it's 3-0 and there is plenty of time left, over 20 minutes left in this match. Now it's about pride for Honduras. It's about pride. You have to get some type of prideful result for your national team, for your country, for yourself.
Third and last substitution for Mexico. Oliver Peralta Morones is coming in. And the one leaving the game, it's gonna be Jesus Corona. Foul over Herrera. It's 69 minutes. So sad when the game was so tight and Honduras was looking, was aiming to tie it. Then there came Irving Lozano, making La Bicolor feel the power of Chucky. What a talent. And what a crack to be he can be, because he's still developing as a soccer player.
And that's great. To be young and still be on the uptick and have the options that he has, you know, it really, it tells that the future is bright for Mexico and all the opportunities that they're going to have with players in the future.
They're trying to fighting for possession. Falling behind and committing the foul. We're going back to the pitch of El Estadio Azteca for another report with the X-Men, Francisco X. Rivera.
Guys, we can underestimate the fact that Carlos Vela finally showed up in a press conference in the last 5 years. He talks about the great mood and the great environment around Mexico's camp right now. I've been through tournaments, whole tournaments, in which Mexico hasn't really talked to the media actually at all, except obviously to us and rights holders across the U.S. and Mexico. With that said, it was a funny thing. It was a good environment there during the press conference. In the beginning, Vela's microphone didn't even work, and Vela was joking around saying, well, it's good that it's off. I don't even want to answer questions. But that obviously changed, and we knew the mood was actually pretty positive.
Long ball aiming for Ellis, and that was easy to control for Paco Memo Ochoa. We were having a conversation right before the kickoff of this game, Kobe Jones and myself, about those attitudes that we usually have when we are younger. Life sometimes is tough on us, and finally we understand, we live, we appreciate what we have. And the good news for Carlos Vela is that he realized everything around him while he still can play the game. So now he's back. He has all his talent on him. There were some rumors that he might go back to play for Chivas. He said it was just a rumor. It wasn't true. The question is if he will remain as a Real Sociedad player. But at 29, 28 years old, he's at the peak of his career.
Yeah, the peak of your career. You're really in the prime of your playing ability. And I think it's because physically you're starting to peak, but also mentally you're starting to mature. And I think that's what's really affected him and Vela, and really becoming that total player where all of a sudden he's back with the national team, back into a good mood, back into really becoming a star, you know, for the side, becoming something more, as one of the players that everyone's looking to be something more.
Probably another thing that helped El Bombardero was the factor that he became a father recently.
That'll,
you learn.
That'll definitely make you mature really quick.
That makes you settle down. As we were looking at the standings so far, Mexico apparently is settling down as the leader of this hex, the road to Russia in CONCACAF. Jimenez from far, putting it wide. We're very close to reach minute 73. It's 3-0. And it doesn't matter that his team is winning, that it is his birthday, Juan Carlos Osorio Arbeláez. It's not happy with the moves that his players are doing right now on the pitch.
I don't think he wants his players to settle. And he wants them to see out the full match in preparation for what's coming next. He understands that you cannot let down at any time, because if you do, that can become a habit and you can pay for it in the long run.
You need to learn two words for the next time we have Professor Osorio on the screen. Are you ready?
Yes.
Feliz cumpleaños.
Happy birthday.
Yes, but do it in Spanish.
Feliz, I got that part.
Cumpleaños.
Cumpleaños.
Woof. Feliz. You're there, my friend. And that's a foul. Oribe suffering the first clash with minor Alexis Figueroa. For a moment, there was a rumor linking Oribe Peralta with the MLS. Everything went south. Nothing happened. We could have seen these two playing the Major League Soccer. Minor as a great central defender with FC Dallas.
There's always a lot of opportunity for these players. As we're seeing, as the sport grows, there's more professional clubs, a lot more happening.
Vela driving, aiming, he lost the ball. I'm sorry, Cubby, I interrupted you.
No, no, just saying with the respect that MLS has now, you're seeing a lot of players willing to come into MLS.
This is the list of the five MLSers playing for Honduras. Called for this game and the next one. Three from Houston Dynamo. Bonic has made a name for himself playing for that franchise. Kyoto still, as Ellis, trying to make a name for themselves. This is Bumsy. Reyes with the cross, and it was the captain, the Jutiapense, Minor Alexis, sending it away. And it's going to be a corner kick for El Tricolor. The report we have between Panama and Costa Rica is that they're still tied kneel to kneel. Juna from the left to high. Los Ticos playing with one man down, only with 10 for the last 20 minutes. Still 0-0. Another cross, looking for the far post, and that was too high for Oliver Peralta Morones. This is a good task for you. You know Oribe's nickname?
Can't say that I do.
Cepillo.
Cepillo.
Cepillo. Brush.
Brush.
Like hairbrush?
Yeah.
There you go.
Cepillo.
Cepillo.
Does every player have a nickname?
Almost. And if not, you can come up with whatever you think.
Fair enough. See if I can have some for the next game.
Oof. And what about the next game? That's a super-duper next game, Kobe Jones.
Sunday. It's coming quick.
Starting at 7:30 Eastern time. The clash, the battle for CONCACAF. Mexico went to Columbus finally to end with the curse of Columbus. The curse of the 2-0. That was a foul. Committed by Johnny Eulogio Palacios.
I feel there's a lot of this group of players has taken on a lot as a national team, the responsibility of wearing the jersey, and they've been successful breaking the curse of the 2-0. And I'll let you say it correctly. Is the Azteco?
Aztecaso?
Aztecaso. They looks like they're going to be breaking that as well. The results that Honduras have had. The previous coach that was there for Costa Rica.
Here comes Jimenez with the ball through. Oribe! There was a little touch, but no, my friend. There was an offside sanctioned by Drew Fisher.
And listen to the fans, they don't care. He's in an onside position, so I think the fans are correct on that one. And that could have been a penalty. If that had been allowed to play out, the correct call was made, it would have been onside, and then that would have been a penalty for Mexico.
But the comment you were mentioning going on Sunday, you and I belong to the same generation. How about if we call it Aztecaso Episode 3?
Aztecaso Episode 3.
And you can add like some sound effects like
I'll let you do the sound effects.
We're less than 12 minutes away to the end of regulation. The party will be complete for Juan Carlos Osorio Arbeláez. The first half of the Hex will be completed. 4 wins, 1 draw for the Mexican side. The first position with one more game to go before playing in Confederations Cup. Vela. And it's Palacios clearing the ball. The lonely man in front, it's Ellis.
And this result's so important for Juan Carlos Osorio, because regardless of the results that he's gotten before, there's been pressure on him. He's won multiple games outside of Azteca. Still pressure on him. Coming into this game, this was probably the most pressure-filled game, because if you do not get a result in this one, there's going to be a questions galore, pressure if Osorio is the right coach for this team. But to get the result here, and a significant one at that, helps him tremendously going into the Confederations Cup.
Vela dropping the ball for Herrera. Tonight, Honduras is visiting Estadio Azteca for its 10th time. The last two, they win one and they tied another one. This could be potentially their 8th defeat and 10 visits to the Colossus of St. Ursula. They have scored 4 goals, and with the 3 of tonight, they have conceded 21. Tough numbers. But also for a tough team, that when they host the Mexicans, they have made them pay. 4 wins, 3 draws, only 3 losses as a home team, La Bicolor. Oribe, that is to control it. And there's Escobar. Maybe his teammates, come on, let's do something, let's wake up. How do you wake up from this type of situation, Scobie? At least one goal will be a mental victory.
And that's exactly it. It's about getting at least one goal. This is just about pride. I mentioned it before for this Honduran side. You know, I believe.
White ball for Lozano, looking for partners. It wasn't for Oribe. Bang! Right bazooka leg. And Raul Alonso Jimenez Rodriguez put it away.
Well, the few times that Honduras do
go. Feliz cumpleaños. Go.
Feliz cumpleaños.
There you go.
That.
There you go.
As Honduras push forward, and they turn over the ball, Mexico is quick to counter, and that's when Honduras gets exposed, because they push that high lineup, balls over the top. We're seeing Irving Lozano, we're seeing Peralta, Jimenez, everyone taking advantage of that, getting beyond and getting numbers into the box. They're just quicker to react at this point in the match.
I think I saw a handball from Oribe. Drew Fisher didn't sanction it. Montana delivers to Achuki. Ball deflected. And it's going to be a throw-in for the Mexican side. Close to the 83rd minute. That was a foul. It was from behind. But no yellow card. Vela has been punished this game.
Yeah, Vela's taken a few hits. And look, he's got to understand this. He's one of the players that is the creative one for Mexico. Other teams know that. They're going to come after you. There will be fouls. There will be sending messages. Finding different ways of trying to slow him down.
But would you be using Vela against the Honduran side, risking him not to be able to play against Team USA, or you're trying to balance those inexperienced players at this level with Gio, Vela?
Well, I've tried to guess what Juan Carlos Osorio is doing in the past, and it hasn't quite worked out. I would think that Vela would have been one of my substitutions to try to have him available for the game against the United States. But going a full 90 here, maybe the thinking is that against the United States, Vela will come off the bench, maybe play 20 or 30 minutes in that game.
And what about El Chucky? Would you give him the big chance to be part of the starting 11 at that such stage?
I think so. I think you could probably put him in on one of the flanks. You know, have him play on that side, especially after the showing here. He's been very successful. But I just think it, for Juan Carlos Osorio, I think he's a smart enough coach to understand that there's a significant difference between playing against Honduras and playing against the United States.
Vela, one possession. He was being followed, and that wasn't a foul by Discoa. Lozano giving it to Vela. 85 minutes. It's 3-0. Osvaldo Aranis. Irving Lozano. Raul Jimenez. One more for El Rulo. He put it behind. Oribe. Now it's Reyes. Bouncy. Being rejected by Izaguirre. Chucky. Mano a mano versus Milo. Right, left. Foul. Committed by Izaguirre Girón. Over Lozano Baena.
It's a very smart play by Lozano. As he moves this ball past him, you watch, he puts that foot in between the player and the ball. So as Aguirre comes in to try to win the ball, it's an automatic foul. So a set piece for Mexico in a dangerous position once again.
This could be the last one. Set play, or would it be a direct kick? That's the question. Two on the wall. Outswing. Oribe was aiming for the header. Palacios. And that ball belongs to Donis Salatier. Escobar Izaguirre.
Now you can see Honduras now. I can tell you, as a team, they just want to get out of the game. 3-0, and they're happy at this point. They do not want to take an extra goal. Everything out of the back really isn't trying to play to anyone up front. It's just clearing it down the field.
That's becoming a heavy monkey on La Bicolor's back. The six that they got from Team USA, and now the three in Mexico City. Well, that could make the difference between being able to get the wild card or not.
Yeah, when you take a massive amount of goals like this, you tend to think, I just want to get out of this game and let's get it over with. But in the long run, games like this end up hurting. As we get towards the end of the hex play, teams are going to start looking for that four spot. And goal differential is going to be a huge part of it.
And we were talking about controversies around Juan Carlos Osorio. That is the same situation that the professor Jorge Luis Pinto Afanador lives. He's a controversial personality. And he's going to be criticized after this result by the Honduran press. You think this is the type of result, especially at the stage we are at the end of the first half of the hex, that Honduras can think about changing their manager?
I think they can, because at where they are, they're probably thinking, what do we have to lose? It can't get much worse than it is. They may look to examples of other teams like the United States that have done something along the lines where they made the change in the manager. So we'll see if Honduras sticks with what they have so far, because as you said, there's controversy already. People are not happy with it. And then you go into Mexico and in the first half of the hex with a 3-0 loss and put yourself in a precarious spot to most likely not make it to the World Cup. I'm sure the higher ups are saying, okay, who can step in and get the job done?
The biggest problem for La Bicolor is that after the first 5 games, it's not only that they were barely able to win 4 out of 15 points. The problem is that they already played 3 games at home. And that's an advantage that you can't let go if you really want to attend a FIFA World Cup.
Yeah, you need to win your home games.
You can't lose points at home. Here's Raul. That way it's Herrera. Jonah. No Vela. The opportunity is for Dueñas. To the move, Lozano with the cross, and it's going from right to left. Rich, the 90th minute.
That pitcher right there is the example. Everyone walking slowly to the ball, wanting to see the end of the match and to get over with it. And remember, this game, it's at Azteca. It's at altitude. And for Honduras, they are probably absolutely exhausted physically and mentally and just want to see this game out.
Did you ever run out of air playing in Estadio Azteca?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. There will be. There's always oxygen tanks on the side, oxygen tanks in the locker room, so you can try to get that second win.
Vela looking probably for the last one for the Mexican side. This is Bumsy. El Huesos with a strike. Not a good one. Herrera. One more for El Zorrillo. Jonah. We're reaching the 91st minute. And this will be the last one for El Chucky. Mano a mano with Izaguirre. Left, right. He lost possession. And there's no more. There's Drew Fisher saying, this is over.